gentlemen, welcome to a new episode of Hollywood Uncensored. I know it's been a goddamn minute since we've been up in here. It is your boy Hollywood Hogan. As always, I am joined by my good brother Rossi Montgomery. Brother, welcome back to the channel and the show.
What's up, man? Yeah, it has been a minute, and I'm like, that's when you said how long. I'm like, holy shit, yeah. So, yeah. Been on the quarantine break still, so you know, but we're surviving.
It's been a roller coaster, man. Now, before we jump into this, because I know this video or this podcast is titled Wonder Woman 84 Review, I do want to take a moment, a few seconds, to send our condolences, pay our respects to the very great and powerful Brody Lee, who unfortunately passed away this last Saturday, a very big tragedy for the wrestling world. It's been a tough year for wrestling. This one felt like the biggest blow of them all at the very young age of 41 years old, in his prime, in my opinion, becoming a superstar at this exact moment. What he was able to do for the Dark Order, it needs to be appreciated, because that stable was getting laughed off of the ring on TV. The Dark Order was like trending many of the times that they would make their way in their entrances. When Brody Lee became the Exalted One and took that stable over, he legitimized the whole entire stable. Not only that, but his match qualities were through the roof. He's always had this talent. I've always said that his Luke Harper character was just underused. They never used him the correct way. He was one of the better big men that were just could do everything. But unfortunately, he passes away, and it's a huge blow, man. So, Brody Lee, rest easy, brother. No, you're up there. I know AEW is having a little ceremony, a little pay of homage to you tomorrow night. It's still a tragic thing, man. It really sucks. It's a really shitty way to end the year, in a year that's been completely shitty.
Here's a big yeah, yeah, yeah to the big man, to the big rig, as he was known. Here's to Brody.
Yeah, man. It sucks, dude. It's a really shitty situation. But let's jump right into this movie review. Wonder Woman 1984, the highly anticipated sequel from the original Wonder Woman movie that came out a few years ago, which was highly successful. I think it made about $100,000 in the box office returns. Director Patty Jenkins, starring the wonderful Gal Gadot, the very powerful Pedro Pascal, and Michelle Pfeiffer. Yeah, I'm calling her Michelle Pfeiffer. She's literally fucking Selina Kyle from Batman Returns. It's beat for beat, bar for bar, dude. They literally just copied it. And it's a cat, if you really think about it. The glasses, the curly, messy hair. She's dropping everything. She gets attacked by a guy. And how does she die? I'll just leave it at that. I know we're going to get to spoilers, but I would just start with this. The two things I like the most about this movie, the score from Hans Zimmer, and I actually like the way Pedro Pascal acted in this movie. I think Pedro Pascal was the only person in the world that actually had a good 2020. Other than that, man, it's not what I expected. The first one was such a gritty, dark war movie. And then for whatever reason, they just flipped the switch and they turned into a Donner Superman ripoff in the 80s. Where they're just trying to, like, most of the time, Gal Gadot's Wonder Woman isn't really doing much. I feel like most of the movie, like, her character is getting more catcalls from men than actually being Wonder Woman. Like, the whole sequence of events, it didn't work for me the way I wanted it to. And the stunts were terrible. I honestly, man, I gave the first Wonder Woman a 7. As of right now, I'm giving Wonder Woman 84 a 4. That's how much I just did not connect with this movie whatsoever. It just felt like an incomplete movie. Like, an hour in, dude, I don't even know what the hell the movie's about. Like, I'm just waiting for something with actual context to happen other than them having all these, like, 80s flares. I get the 80s and 90s are nostalgic and they're in right now because you see them all over the place. But, like, I just feel like they missed the beat that they had in the first movie. I don't know if you felt that way, but it felt completely different. It felt like almost like they were rebooting the character than actually just continuing the story.
No, that's funny that you ended it with that. I actually didn't sit down to watch the first one for the longest time. Not to be a dick or anything. I'm lazy. And then the way the world continues to go, I get even lazier. but when I finally sat down and watched it, I enjoyed it and everything. But the funny thing with the newer DC movies that have come out in recent years, most of the ones that everybody praises aren't the ones that I think the world of. So Wonder Woman, an example, everybody said it was amazing. I thought it was a decent movie. Wasn't bad. but it wasn't anything that I was sitting there like, I can't wait for the sequel.
Yeah.
But nonetheless, you know, this one, yeah, you nailed it with the ending of saying that it felt like a reboot. It really did. It didn't, to me, feel like the same, and this is already taken heat, it did not feel like the same Wonder Woman that we first saw in Batman versus Superman. Didn't feel like the Wonder Woman that came in Wonder Woman. It just felt like they were kind of doing their own version of it. And I have to correct you, because they were so similar. You said it was Michelle Pfeiffer. It was Kristen Wiig. Even worse for playing Cheetah to me, because I'm like, you have someone like that that's, you know, known for being a comedian on Saturday Night Live, everything. And then must we try to always forget about that god-awful piece of shit Ghostbusters movie that came out? So you have that of all these kind of trying to redeem it, but it really was, and that's funny that you now sit there and compare them, because it very much was watching like Batman Returns with the whole Catwoman arc.
Oh, that's why I called her that.
Okay, that's good. I'm like, no, I didn't put that together, because I'm like, that's very true, because nothing really happens. And then when she finally takes full, you know, Cheetah persona, it's still very much just like, okay, now she's Cheetah. Now you're going to do it. Now they're going to fight. And now they're in the water. And now she's kind of normal again. But they never really explain how she goes back to being normal once people watch and everything, you know, spoiler, non-spoiler, whatever, of the whole wishes and whatnot. Who makes the decision of what wishes came true? Or what wishes actually went back to normal was the big deal that I actually read people talking about saying, well, this one went back to normal. That one, it just seemed like a lot of shit being thrown out there for the sake of a story.
Yeah.
And like most of it did not get solved in the end.
No.
Or they tried wrapping it up in the last like 25 minutes.
It's a long and just movie like too.
Boom, boom, boom. Yeah. That's when I start noticing it again of people that love to bitch for the sake of bitching get complained about Batman versus Superman being too long and not being a good movie. This movie was way too fucking long and a mediocre movie. You kind of nailed it. You gave it that Bret Hart 4 out of 10 rating. I think that kind of stands. Like that's,
I wanted to love this movie. Here's the thing, man. I heard about this movie being messy since March. Because originally it was going to come out in June, obviously. Because the biggest thing that I heard a lot of people complain about that went to like the test screenings, that they said it was like a rom-com in the 80s. And I could see that sense, because there was no point of bringing back Chris Pine. That never made sense. It was like, for what reason other than you wanted to sell tickets originally? That was obviously...
They wanted Captain Kirk back.
They needed him back. He should have been playing Captain Kirk. That would have made way more sense than bringing back Steve Trevor.
And not to cut you off, but good. The whole thing, you'll get into it as you keep going right now.
Yeah.
Just real quick, I'll say it. The sake of bringing him back was one thing, but he barely did anything in this
film. Yeah.
So it was even more so the fact, okay, now, so I guess I'm going to stick with saying on the other side of Marvel always being upset that all these people come back from the dead, yet we've never seen Quicksilver come back. This is why we probably haven't seen Quicksilver come back, because you bring the character back for a movie and then do fucking damn near nothing with them.
That's so funny that you bring that up.
Yeah, see, we'll get...
I know. I literally read about that shit this morning. I feel you on that. It's like he literally did nothing but play the love interest for possessing a guy that she didn't even know she made the wish to begin with. And that whole scene where the invisible jet happens, which is canon, which is a big, you know, Wonder Woman thing, obviously.
Went over my head. Right over my head at first.
It was cool up into the moment where they're, like, flying over the fireworks. I'm like, oh, cool, I'm watching Aladdin. I'm like, this is what this movie has turned into. I'm like, it's a magic carpet ride with Steve Trevor and Diana. And it's like, I don't understand, because the movie starts with that, like, epic gladiator-type scene where she's, like, in that contest.
Okay.
And I'm like, if that's the theme of the movie, I dig it. You know, I like the whole mythology, the Greek gods, the stuff that they kind of tested in the first one with Ares. That stuff's cool. They cut through that scene and they go into the mall scene, and then it just gets worse from there on. The mall scene, dude, the CGI was awful. There's a moment where one of the bad guys screams no. shit you not, it's one of the worst no's I've heard since Hayden Christensen said no in the Darth Vader helmet. It was just awful from the beginning. The CGI, you've had since March this movie was finished, and the CGI was still bad in December. Like, how, I know because of COVID restrictions, it's harder to go back and film things, but like, that's computer animated stuff. There were moments where she's like running down that like street and they zoom in for whatever reason. And I'm like, oh, cool. This must have been directed by CW. This must be directed by the Flash directors, because it looks awful, man. It's just like the CGI was just bad. And I just, none of the movie made sense. The one thing I will say, who's the other villain in Batman Returns? Not the Penguin, not Catwoman, billionaire dude, the one who kind of kills Selina Kyle, throws her off.
Christopher Walken?
Yeah, there you go. It's Maxwell Lord. It's literally Maxwell Lord as well. It's beat for beat, dude. Like,
so that's what Wonder Woman 84 was, just Batman Returns.
It's Batman Returns, the ripoff, almost.
But they just flip it. They're like, yeah, now it's a strong female
pretty
kind
much
of doing shit. And but she didn't have a love in, or she did have a love
she
in.
Did.
She should have been with Cheetah, though.
That would have been.
And then it would have flipped it. Then it would have been Tim Burton's just.
Then we get the wacky-ass trees. Elfman. Fucking, then we get the wacky trees and shit. We get the penguins with the missiles on their back. Then it would have been a better movie, honestly.
It would have been great.
Another thing I had a problem with was it just the storytelling of it. Like, a whole hour passes, like I said, you don't get what's happening. Maxwell Lord just wants to grant wishes to people, which I'm like, okay, dude, like, wouldn't you rather just wish for power instead of just being the genie? Literally, that's what they turned him into. It just feels like the entire movie was, it felt, like I said, like, it felt like a reboot. And here's another thing, to go back to Batman Returns. How does Selina Kyle kind of commit suicide in Batman Returns? Power cord, right?
Oh, yeah.
How does Cheetah turn back to power cord? Like, dude, there were so many, like, resemblances to that movie where I'm like, it would have been a lot cooler if it was dark tone, but it just didn't fit for what I thought that Wonder Woman was capable of. You make her seem like such a badass, no matter what you think of BVS or Wonder Woman or even Justice League, it's canon, not canon, whatever would they come out with. I think this is like her fourth time playing that character now, but she doesn't really do what you think she's capable of doing. In BVS, she mentions that she left humanity for like 100 years because of what she saw the world can do to themselves. But there she is in the 80s, running around, fucking flying and shit with the plane. So I'm like, where is the story continue? Where does it brush off? I expected a little bit better. I think that's my biggest problem. I expected something more action, more just, they made her look weak, and I get why they did, because, you know, Kristen Wiig was for the powers and all that stuff. Other problem I had, because I just remembered, I was going to say it earlier, every guy has to catcall her. Every guy, I get women empowerment. I'm all for it, 100%. In the first Wonder Woman movie, you didn't have to throw it in our face. She just did it. She walked out of the trenches.
Men.
She walked out of the trenches. It's like a South Park episode, dude. Like, every guy is literally catcalling her in this movie. And I'm like, that's the problem. You're doing the problem that kind of Star Wars and the new trilogy did, where you're forcing it upon your audience and it feels cheapened. In the first one, she didn't need that shit. She was just a badass. She was fighting fucking in the First World War. This one, she can't even walk through the street without like six men whistling at her and like try to pick her up and stuff. It just felt so like cringe about it. And it might be because who wrote it. I know Geoff Johns wrote this one. I know there's a lot of problems with him in DC right now. He's being accused of some like bad shit. And from what I heard, he's kind of the reason why Affleck didn't want to direct the Batman movie anymore. So it might be, he might be the common ground for everything that's kind of been happening with like the solo movies. But yeah, I'm going to stick with the four, man. I kind of wanted to talk myself into a five because it did get kind of better when she was wearing that gold plated like armor.
And like the Goldar suit.
Yeah. Yeah. I was like, it kind of did get a little bit better right there at that moment. The fight scene with Cheetah, I kind of dug it in the third act. It looked a lot better than I thought it was going to look. That's the one complaint I won't give people. They said that like she looked crappy. And I was like, she's a cheetah. Like, what? How else do you want a person that turns into a cheetah to look like? It's like, this isn't Cats the musical. Sorry, oh, that Taylor Swift isn't coming from the ceiling like a cat. Like, this is, it's Cheetah. And like, no offense to Kristen Wiig, she did like the best she could with the role they gave her. But I just wish it wasn't a recycled villain role that we've seen in all these comic book movies for like years now.
Yeah, no, I mean, that's, yeah, no, I thought I was going to like talk even more shit on it, but I'm like, that kind of like nails it though. Cause was it, like the word was it okay, let's put it this way. Was it Incredible Hulk bad? No.
No, no.
But it definitely wasn't if how things are going now, how they said the Pattinson Batman is gonna be in its own different world. This has nothing to do with these ones. If they're trying to still build on this franchise and this time frame and everything, they're doing a piss poor job, because now all of their trust really is falling on the Flash movie that may or may not be great. And it has all the reasons to be interesting. Yeah, it has all the reasons not to be great because of all these, but it also has all the chances that it could turn it. But I don't know. I feel like DC is, once again, they see and hear Marvel doing anything, so they're like, oh, we got to do this shit now, put it out. And kind of even see that with them being like, oh, there's going to be spinoffs of every single movie in the next year or two. And now this movie is going to get one. And now this is it could be good or it could be overkill. And you'll still have movies coming out and shows coming out, but the shit that you put out isn't good. So no one's going to want to wait around for what else you got. And that's kind of how I honestly feel about the Snyder Cut in general, where I'm like, there's too much shit going on now. You're throwing too much stuff into it. And now because of you finally getting it, there's a lot more coming out, like possibly Jared Leto still. So now I'm upset again. And now I'm like, fuck, you know. But either way, for Wonder Woman, yeah, it just of how upset they still are that it didn't get a necessarily good, you know, theatrical run. I'm like, that wouldn't have saved it. You would have probably and easily lost more money, because we're not the only two that said it. I saw reviews about it, and I'm usually not someone that not necessarily believes but trusts the reviews of certain movies. This one that I saw was pretty good, because when it first came out, like the first two nights, people liked it. People said it was really good, all this good talk. After a couple days and more people saw it, that's when the reviews started turning. And that's when I started looking, being like, okay, well, that's interesting. And then sitting down and watching it, I'm like, no, that fucking nailed it. Like, it just...
Yeah. It's one of those things, man, that's like... And you know me, I'm like, I'm pro DC. You've always known that. I've always been like such a stand for like everything that they've done. Even the Snyder Cut, which, shout out to Warner Brothers for actually sending it to me for free. I dig it. So don't like take away my stuff, because I'm probably shitting on Wonder Woman. They're probably like, fucking take him off the list.
Get him and get that fucker off of there. They're saying bad things about King Snyder.
Yeah, but it's like, I'm going to be open-minded about it. Like, I've seen, it's not worse than Suicide Squad. Like, if I'm going to keep it in DCEU, I'll keep it there. It's not worse than Suicide Squad. But man, I don't know if you watched it, but I think Birds of Prey, I think I like Birds of Prey a little bit more than I liked Wonder Woman 84. I think I enjoyed it more, and it just made me want to watch it again more than watch Wonder Woman 84 again. Like, I get the message in Wonder Woman 84, which was like a big thing that people keep reviewing. Like, oh, the message at the end, what like Diane is saying to Max. I'm like, yeah, that's great. It took 2 hours and 30 minutes to get to this point. Like, you had an entire movie to kind of like sink that in to the breaking point, but instead you're just like here and there. You fucking end up in Egypt. It turns into an Indiana Jones movie at one point, and they're back in DC. Then the president.
She's even got a little Asian friend with her. No.
Well, yeah. Well, Maxwell Lord's son. I mean, there you go, dude.
Oh, shit.
Yeah, she's so
I had a little short round with her.
And technically, he's the one that's telling Maxwell Lord to like re-wish his wish, and that's kind of like a chain reaction of events that ends up happening.
One of the deleted scenes is him calling someone Dr. Jones, and they're like, no, we gotta cut it out. That's too on the nose.
He was wearing a hat and the pre-existing cuts and stuff. But I can't wait to see the Patty Jenkins cut of Wonder Woman 84.
Oh my God. She's like, yeah. I swear it was better. I'm like, no, it wasn't. I'm a liar.
That's not what I heard. But the great line, they said it was... that's the thing too, that I've known that it was going to be messy from the beginning. Another problem with it, it's like, I could see why there's more like negative stuff going around, because it did release on the streaming app, which that's why I'm not like, if there's spoilers and you got spoiled, and this is a totally different situation. You could have watched this movie for the last like 6 days already, or 5 days. Like, it's not like it's in the theaters. You could easily, it's there. It's easy to watch at this point. Usually I'm good with spoilers, but I'm not going to keep it spoiler free for a movie that's literally on streaming apps. except only in the United States. That's the only shitty part. But still, they got to watch in theaters. They're not shitty like us here in the U.S.
They had Titans before us, so fucking deal with it.
Well, that's the thing I was going to bring up with Titans, man. You said, like, they're doing spinoffs now. I mean, if it's Titans-based, then cool. If they're going to do shows like Deathstroke and stuff like that, like, that's the plan. I'm down with that. I know the rumor is Affleck doing a Batman series on HBO Max as well, depending how they do that. Like you said, though, The Flash, it's either going to make or break the DCEU. It's either going to save it and make, like, the future very bright and have, like, all these situations that they could do it, or it's going to retcon it to a point where, like, they bury themselves even more. Like, and they're holding a lot of hope on the Snyder Cut, man. I love how they pretty much ditched Snyder. And they're like, yeah, man, you can go, to the point where now they're like, please let this fucking 4-hour movie save us from everything that we've done at this point. And it's like, yeah, I had hope up until the point where you brought Leto's annoying ass back. It's like, you could change them all you want, man. I mean, I'm still not going to dig it. I'm not going to like it.
And that's the thing now, too, that, I mean, Leto aside, I fucking hate him. But two biggest things that bother me now about the Snyder Cut are, one, it's not your cut anymore, or it's not your version when you start adding new things. Then it's a brand new movie. Then you can just say, hey, I'm making my own version. This isn't the original, like, he cut or like he shot, because you've added too many things to it now. So that's already, to me, I'm like, it's a little bit different. Fine, whatever. The next biggest thing is how they've kind of gone back and forth of, oh, well, it's going to be in different like episode form. Yeah, and now it's chapters. Just a 4-hour movie.
No, it's still going to be four chapters.
Oh, it is. Okay.
So you have the option. Yeah, which is the, but this is the shitty part, though. This is the shitty thing. You can either watch 4 hours of it at IMAX if your fucking world isn't being destroyed by COVID, or you can watch it at home but do like four chapters per week. But it's like, okay, good luck avoiding spoilers for the people that watched the 4 hours of the movie.
Well, and that's the problem with releasing anything, even like the Marvel front, any show that now releases like one episode at a time, I think I get it, but at the same point, once it's going to a streaming site, just put it all on there, you know, and let people either fucking binge it immediately or watch bit by bit. But yeah, I don't know. I feel like now it's just, well, especially with that, you get a 4-hour thing and you're going to release once a week, or allegedly. I feel like you're going to lose a lot in doing it because you're trying to build it, but it's not a show, it's just a movie. So watching the movie, yeah, I don't know. Again, it could be good, it could be a stupid fucking idea. That's totally just opinion based. But yeah, I don't know, because also I'm the type that's like, once it's done, is it done, or are you trying to do something with this? And now, yeah, like you said, he wants to do they want to do Affleck on his own, they want to do this, but again, I'm like, are you going to continue to build this world, or are you going to fucking just keep redoing it to where no one knows who is going to see each other, or maybe they won't, and you just go back to basics of being like, you're all just in your own fucking movie, leave us alone. And if that's the case, that's fine. But yeah, I don't think any of them really know, and maybe that's the hard part. They're just like, we're just gonna fucking win it. And
well, I mean, it worked out in like Snyder's advantage for that to happen, because I mean, he was pretty much out, man, and he grabbed them by the balls and he was like, I could save you guys and just give me all the money in the world and now remake Justice League. And I'll put in Leto, and I'll put in the Green Lantern, and I'll put in Martian Manhunter, and I'll put in all this other stuff, which is like, it's either going to be hit or miss. I know the Leto scene is it's another nightmare scene. So take that for what that is. I don't know in what capacity the Joker would be used in like a dark side world that's happening.
Well, I've heard again, non-spoiler, the movie's not even fucking out, but I've heard that it's like, allegedly he will, I guess I would take that as helping. He's going to have something to do with getting one of the mother boxes and possibly get it for Flash. But I'm like, so in the nightmare world, he's a hero, or he's good? Because I get, But then also, I'm like we said, he looks completely different. He's going to have this and that. So in the nightmare version, does he get rid of all his stupid fucking tattoos and grill? Or is it that never happened? Or
I think because I know they said the look changed. From what I heard, it was the tattoos are gone, but the grill is still there because like Snyder, that was Snyder's like design from the beginning. Because like the whole
He was a big Usher fan in the fucking early 2000s. He's like, I want it.
Well, when Snyder like explains it, it sounds better because he's just like, oh, Batman broke all his teeth. And I'm like, okay, I could kind of get behind that, but explain that, show that.
But if you wanted to really like, if you want to, again, if you want to make it like a nightmare scene, wouldn't it be more fucked up if, all right, Batman broke all his teeth, make his teeth all fucked up then?
Yeah.
Make him like own that up and be like, ah, look, now they look all fucking razor sharp or something stupid. Like, I don't know.
And
that's one part that bugs me. But either way, I'm like, that's neither going to make your, you know, save it. It's just one of those little.
It might break it for me, to be honest.
Exactly.
It might be like, dude. And that's another thing, too, because there's another thing that I've heard that they are going to mention or show something to do with the Robin that has died, which I'm like, I was like, don't show him twice. I just get the nightmare scene over with.
Exactly.
The crowbar live action version. Cause I mean,
well, not if they're just going to half-ass it. If you're going to put that in an actual movie and actually take that, you know, story. All right. But again, in a Justice League movie, why are you showing so much? Then again, you have 4 fucking hours. But why are you showing so much backstory of certain things when it just should be on that story of this is the team, this is what they're doing. Oh, here's a nightmare scene. Here's still the team or not. And that's the problem, too, where I'm like, now you're throwing just too many things of every character because you want more about that one, which I get. But at the same time, do that on its own. That again, that's. He's trying to make a movie involving all these characters, but in that one movie, he's trying to have all fucking movies going on. It's like Zack Snyder is turning on like 7 different screens behind him and being like, okay, hit record. And you're like, fucking what? Like, what are you doing, man? Like he thinks that's how Marvel fucking figured out how to put him. You're like, no, dude, this isn't an episode of Robot Chicken. Like, you gotta plan a little bit.
Little mini shots of just every single character.
That's honestly how it feels like. And the more I hear, oh, well, this is going to be going on with Flash and this is going to be Batman. That's this. And that's, and I've heard the least about Superman, which I guess is kind of funny because this is his
key.
Yeah. This is his time to be like, oh, he's got his black suit on and this and that. I'm like, yeah, but other than that, I haven't heard fucking anything to do with Superman in this. And that's still the biggest thing in the Justice League that'll never be mentioned ever again. I didn't mind Superman when he came back because he was campy. And that's what Superman is to me, where Batman can have that, you know, dark to him and story. Superman really can't. And maybe that's what people argue with me on. But I'm like, Superman's a fucking, he's campy as shit. So seeing him fight whoever and be like Zim to the moon and stupid stuff like that, I laugh and I enjoy.
Yeah.
Again, everybody else and their fucking grandmother that saw the film hated it. And that's again what makes me different. I like some comic stuff. I like when they take their own version. I like when they make it dark. I like some that are light. So you pick and choose, I guess, but if this movie is just dark, brooding Superman and not doing anything Superman related, that's kind of be my problem back with Man of Steel, where you're like, you're trying to make me feel for him and be upset and this and that. Yet why, you know, he's got to stop someone from murdering innocent children and families or he's not. And him crying about it isn't going to make me feel any fucking bad. You know, it's not going to change it. It's still going to be like, are you going to stop him or not, dude? Because
well, that's always been like Hollywood's thing of trying to humanize the most of Superman and be like, this is Superman for today's age. And it's like
he's a fucking alien.
It's like he's literally God on this planet. It's like,
yeah,
he's living among us. Like that's the way it is. And I think I was fine with the Man of Steel just because I'm like, fine, it's the origin story. first chapter, he has to find his way to that point. And I'm like you said, like, I didn't mind him showing up being campy. I will say, you're doing the black suit. Why can't he just have the mullet and the beard
exactly
at the same time? I'm like, if you're going to do it, go all in. Like, if you're going to spend so much money, you're going to freaking bring in Martian Manhunter out of nowhere into this movie when he has no placement in any of the other movies. You're just going to bring that dude in for a cameo scene. I'm like, you can't get the dude a mullet and the beard and just have him just show up in a way that kind of makes sense a little bit. Like, I just go full in, have the dude wear a beard. It's not that big of a deal. I mean, the biggest
he already got rid of his mustache, just CGI a beard on him. Couldn't look any worse, you know? Like, it's no, but that's the big thing again of bringing in characters that you're kind of like, why? Martian Manhunter. Most people don't know who he is still. You know what I mean? So it's kind of one of those things that, could it work? Yeah, sure. Does it have to work in this light? No, not at all, because why? Like, and again, because that'll be the next thing too. I'm like, will there be a scene at some point in the movie, like the ending, where you have every single one of these characters lined up? I'm sure that'll look cool together. But if that's the only thing that you're building towards, it kind of seems like a waste of time to me, you know?
Yeah, the Martian Manhunter scene, you know who he's playing, right? Like, you know who he's, like, as undercover or who he's trying to pretend to be at the moment?
Yeah, he's the army guy, right? The like the sergeant or the
colonel. So he's been in the movies since Man of Steel. So I guess that's, like, the beat that's made sense since that first movie. And then, but, like, just to have him just appear like that. Like, so he's just going to appear for a random Lois scene. But Homeboy's not going to show up for literally every other fight scene that's happened since Man of Steel. Like, he literally just watched Superman.
He's like, he's got it.
Yeah, he's like, he's getting his ass beat, but I'm going to stay human. Like, I saw them fight Doomsday. They're good. They got one
alien.
There.
That alien over there is fine.
And then when Ryan Reynolds shows up, that would be even the best part, because I can't wait to see everybody's reaction when that happens.
That's going to be strange. Yeah. And, you know, again, if that's the whole point of all of this, kind of building towards these certain moments, then fine. But I got to let my dog outside real quick. No, but you know, it's one of those things that I'm just like, again, if this is all worth it and this is all that we're building towards, I guess it's
fine. What's the payoff?
But yeah. No, I feel you. Hold on one second.
No, go for it, brother. Yeah, ladies and gentlemen, as you could tell, I mean, look, I didn't hate Wonder Woman all that much. It didn't feel like what I was expecting from that character. Like, the first one, gritty war movie. This one, campy, Donner Superman aesthetic, stuff like that. I'm hoping the third Wonder Woman, which Warner Brothers is already literally pushing out of the canon, and saying that Patty's back and Gal's back, which is fine. It's Wonder Woman, man. Focus on her mythology. She's a Greek god, for crying out loud. She fights gods and monsters and shit like that. Focus on shit like that. Like, I get that you guys want to have her, like, here in, like, the United States and make her, they're trying to turn her into Superman, which that has never been, like, Wonder Woman's quote-unquote personality. She's a god. That's what she does, you know? Like, have her fight the gods. Have her go up there. Do her thing. Like, that you could have a Gods of War movie starring Gal Gadot, and I guarantee you the reception would be so much bigger than her saving a child at the mall. Like, it's just that's the thing that knows even the most. Like, this is a god.
Like, that's actually going to be her Robin. That was the whole setup to that. You got to save the kid to. No, but exactly, yeah. And to maybe to put a pin in the Wonder Woman
go for it
franchise of it. Is the whole thing again that I did see Gal say that she really doesn't want to be in a time era in the next movie. She wants to be in, like, present time. She feels like she's done enough with Wonder Woman in the 80s, in the past, and this and that, to where I agree, because one of those, again, I think everybody just cashed in on, oh, it's the nostalgia and it could work. But again, it's like, we already saw her do anything and everything in Batman Superman. You had her say this comments, like you said, I haven't done this for years and years, I went away and all this shit,
just 20 years.
Yeah, exactly. So you're like, what? The one thing that I do really the ending of it is, since watching that one, if you saw people talking about of, oh well, this happened in 84, which had nothing to do with it, but I caught that part, saying that, oh, other people would have made wishes and then you had to take them back and you had to deal with it. I saw one review or one story saying, well, what if Batman at that time or Bruce Wayne wished for his parents back because it was 1984? My question is, did they ever say what year his parents died?
No.
Because that was the biggest part immediately to me. I'm like, the fuck does 84 have to do with anything?
I think it was before 84 that they died, that's technically.
That's what I would have thought, too.
Yeah, because he's but even, way older.
Even so, you're like, okay, he might have, but then that's the problem again. Why do you have to keep bringing them into it? Why do you have to keep being like, oh, what would have fucking Superman wish for at this time? Nothing. He was in a fucking ship coming to Earth, like, you know? But it's just... it's such a small thing, but to me, again, it's the trying to continue and trying to what's it called, kind of trying to tie in every single character in movie. I'm like, not everything has to be tied in so close. You can have the movies and be like, yeah, this is what she was doing during this time. What were the others doing? They weren't fucking doing anything. Like, you know, but
yeah, I just, my whole thing is like the build up to it for everything they had set up already. It was kind of like they told, like, kind of give Patty like full permission to do whatever she wanted. But it's like, that's cool. I'm fine with you giving directors the full, you know, capabilities to do whatever fucking movie they want to do. But it's like, at the same time though, man, a lot of it just, I don't know. I just, if they do a present day movie, then just have her fight somebody that's actually capable of fighting. Like, have her fucking go home or just fight people that are like actually on her level, not a girl who's a scientist that wishes to be a cheetah. Like, you know what I mean? Like, I know that's her villain. I get that. I'm all for that. But it's like, she's also, that's the problem. It's like, man, like, there's, like you said it though, I'm not trying to show your take on this, but like, people have that nostalgia for the 80s Superman. They love those fucking Donner movies, man. Like, they're always going to love Donner's Superman and those Superman 1 and 2 and 3 until it got really shitty with 4 and 5. But it's like they just love that style of superheroes, and Warner Brothers wants to turn that into something. And it's like, yeah, but not her. Do that with Henry Cavill. You got the guy right there. Or shit, do the CW one. I don't know what the hell you guys are doing with that show. I know that's happening. I know they changed the suit and it looks fine, but I'm like, I don't know what's happening in that show, but do it with him. Like, I'm fine with that.
The worst part that's happening with that show is apparently he has 2 sons.
Mm-hmm.
Fucking how? It just brings us to the Mallrats conversation that Brody and TS have. How the fuck can Lois pop out 1, let alone 2, not normal half kids without dying? Like, and even more so, I'm like, so now it's not a show just about Lois and Clark or Lois and Superman. Now I have to watch him be a father? But like, no, and I honestly wasn't gonna watch it beforehand, but that was the nail right there to me, that I'm just like, yeah, you're not trying to make this show about the characters, you're trying to make it a show that people can watch as a family and be like, oh, look, it's a fucking alien in a fucking
CW as well. I mean, it's like CW has a big get since fucking Smallville and Arrow season 1 and 2, and then everything fell apart real quick for them. They just, like you said, I don't know how he does it, but he somehow does it. I mean, maybe he does what he did in, what was it, Superman 2, when he just gives up his powers.
Just so he can fuck?
I guess. That's what he does. He did in the second one. And he's people like, are still whatever. Like, I love that too. Like, he literally gave his powers up just to get it in. And people are like, that movie's for kids, man. That's my childhood. It's like, yeah.
Technically, if that's the case, we've already seen that with Superman Returns. That piece of shit movie that everybody wants to forget about, but I won't. He going back, holy shit, years now. I don't know, we'll look it up later on. I don't know what year that one came out.
2004, I think.
Fuck. Yeah, that sounds about right. Oh my god. But the whole thing is, Lois has a kid, and the whole time he's like, oh wow, that's, you know, he's an alien, doesn't know what kids are, I don't know. But halfway or more than halfway in the movie, I remember the scene so vividly, just being like, fucking what? Lois is getting like beat up or something like that, and the kid's there, and then out of nowhere he just pitches a piano at like the bad guy, and like him and Lois look at each other shocked, obviously making the viewer think this is the first time he's ever fucking done that, and more so being like, so that stupid man's kid, when did he fuck? Like, or when did he fuck Lois and have her forget?
Well, because the whole, Superman Returns is supposed to be the runoff of when he gave up his powers to get it in. Yeah. Which I'm like, why would you... Like, if you can't have the actual Superman and Lois, what's the payoff? Like, you can't just recast them.
And it's like, so he just ran really fast or flew around the world and made them forget and be like, take that. So now he didn't have to pay child support? Or, like, what was the whole point? Like,
he avoided his fucking spouses and child support. He just owes for the last.
He's like, I might be a hero, but I'm not that good of a hero.
Well, that's the thing. Like, he only disappeared for 5 years. I'm like, it's kind of shitty. At least it came back. But Superman
was like, whatever.
Ass, man. The only redeeming quality was, I guess, Lex Luthor, even though you can't say that anymore because that guy's...
Yeah, I know. I'm like, can't say his name. We'll get fucking Benoit and shit like that. What? Like,
ah, man. No, but yeah. So Wonder Woman 84. What a fucking pale of a movie that was. Look, man, next one is Snyder Cut. Coming out March. Rumored to come out March. We'll see what the remains of that movie or show brings and where that takes us here in the DCEU. But yeah, I don't know, man. DC is doing their thing. I know WandaVision for Marvel comes out January. I know the Falcon and the Winter Soldier comes out, what, January as well, doesn't it?
I think so. I saw WandaVision coming out first. I don't know if I saw the
Loki
other.
And all them.
Yeah.
So. What'd you think of those trailers?
I mean, I'm interested, you know, to kind of see what they do in general and then how it all ties in, more so like the WandaVision show. Yeah. Since it's supposed to tie in with Doctor Strange and also Spider-Man. So you know, I'm curious, and I mean, my holding out hope for that is that there was rumor that that was going to be the one, that's how they're going to bring in the X-Men and bring in these different franchises, because you're messing with time and whatnot. If that's still the plan and the case, I'm curious as to how it'll go. I'm curious if they will rewrite their own history and then make it so that they're like, oh, look, Magneto is your dad, or some weird shit like that, because who knows? But
I think they're having the twins in this fucking show, too. So it's like, I wouldn't be shocked if they call them mutants, like, right off the bat.
True. And just almost like act like it was nothing, maybe make that the joke of like, that's always been the word, you know what I mean? But I don't know. There's, again, same. Yes, I'm pro Marvel, you know, nine times out of 10, but it has a lot of promise and a lot of chance to make it. But like any other, it could fail very quickly too, or just make more kind of headaches and questions for people. So I don't know.
There's a lot of these shows that they announced that I kind of don't care about, man. Like, they announced so many. The one that pissed me off the most was Secret Invasions just being a series. I'm like,
yeah,
you're going to do that storyline with just a series of Samuel, which I love Samuel L. Jackson, but like, that's not a series, dude. That could be literally a whole franchise of movies.
Well, and even, well, more so because of the series like type, how many of these big actors are you going to get to even do a cameo on that? You know what I mean? And yeah, we already started with, you know, they got Samuel L. Jackson and whatnot, but Secret Invasion is just as big, if not more at times, than Civil War. How would you have done a show on Civil War? Even the movie version, because obviously it was different, but how are you going to do something that big? How would you do, like, justice-wise, since we've seen horrible versions of it, how would you do the Dark Phoenix saga on a television? You know, how would you do, because there's so much to build off of it. And again, we've seen things that kind of translate and transfer over all right, but that's one I don't know. And then same with some of the other shows, you know, the Armor Wars and stuff like that.
Yeah,
it could be really interesting, but at the same time, I'm still upset that I want the Rhodey version from the cartoon. So I want Rhodey with a fucking mullet. I want him with a Superman black suit mullet. So rock a wig on Don Cheadle and I'll sign up tomorrow, because it would just look fucking hilarious. But well,
that's the thing. It's like a lot of these just seem like it's a little bit too much. Like, I don't need a Groot solo series. That's like,
no,
Like, it's just like, I get it. You have Disney Plus, you guys are killing it, but it's like, you're oversaturating the market with like every single storyline. And then when you do Secret Invasion, then it's like Samuel Jackson and just some of like the other side characters are going to be in it. It's like, that makes no sense. Like, fucking
no.
Daredevil from Netflix and Punisher and all those guys, bring them in, do like continue their story arcs instead of bringing on these other stories that have like no sense or they don't need it at the moment. Like Ironheart. I'm fine with the female Iron Man. They want to do it, fine. Feels like it's a little too soon. Like, you just let go of that character. Just run it back and then also have Brody come back. Is like, it's such a like cluster of so many shows all at once. I'm like, you don't need all that many. Like, it's not that like big of a series to be doing over and over again.
No. And I mean, again, you know, with the shows, you're going to tie in everything. Well, depending on how many shows release at the same time or in the same time frame, I'm already someone that has a hard enough time watching new shows, new movies in general. I'm not about to fucking sign away my life and watch religiously all these different shows, kind of the same way with the CW when they did all their crossovers. I just watched the crossover episodes. I wasn't going to be caught dead watching any more than one episode of Batwoman. You know, like, I wasn't going to watch all these different things. Just give me the fucking big episode and I'll watch it. Give me the big crossover movie version and I'll watch it. But building so much around, like you said, they have so much faith in, you know, Disney Plus and now like not so much HBO Max, that's more DC, but of all these different styles and streaming sites, it could have all the, you know, chance in the world, or it can just be overkill. And
it's headed to like Star Wars did their presentation. They're like, we're doing like 5 shows. Cool. Marvel was like, we're doing 20. And it's like, fuck, dude, like I can't, I'm not going to watch it every week. They're literally want to do like Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday. It's like, that's a chore, bro. Like, I don't want
like, I can't watch two different wrestling companies on a fucking weekly basis.
Exactly.
How the hell do you think I'm going to watch different comic book things? I'm not a child anymore. I can't do that. I don't have that mentality, you know?
That was my thing, dude. I'm like, you guys are lucky I got through The Mandalorian, because I could have checked out a long ass time ago, but I stuck with it because we're on lockdown, so I have nothing else to do. So it's like, you guys were like perfect timing to drop it. But it's like, if they ever do get better, which I hope to God they do, but if they do get better, it's going to be tougher to like want to stay home and be like, what's like this week's episode? So it's just a chore to continue to do it, but we'll see what happens. Disney Plus is killing it, but it's like, I don't know, man. I just wish Secret Invasion just had a better. That could have been the next chapter for, I guess, what they're doing now is the Young Avengers from the way things look. One more thing before we get into our questions. Thoughts on Spider-Man. I know we grew up through that era. Now the rumors are that we're getting all 3 Spider-Mans in Spider-Man 3. They're already bringing back the villains. William Dafoe better come back as the Goblin. That's all I'm going to say. I know it's a rumor right now. If he does come back, you have my money, Marvel. I will be there. Dr. Octopus coming back already, the original actor that played him. That already kind of has it because I'm a big fan of Spider-Man 2. But you bring back William Dafoe's Goblin, it's going to get real lit in there, man. But what are your thoughts of what they're doing? Do you think it's a little bit too much that they're doing as well, like everything else? Or do you think it's going to be like one of the most epic things that we've seen in the comic book movie?
That's what's funny. That's a good like 2-part question. Because it's like, I think if they stuck with Spider-Man as of now and are like, this is going to be the one that throws a bunch of shit at you. We're going to have this character and that fucker. I think if they stick with that and not worry about the shows for a good hot second, it could be great. Now, again, throwing so much at someone at once in a 2 to 3 hour time frame of a film, yeah, it definitely could still be a lot. I know the rumor is that probably people won't like is that, oh, all these different characters, they're probably not going to be in the whole film. There's probably going to be different shots and maybe some that are like, boom, done, and there goes the Goblin. And, you know, I think that'll probably piss some people off depending on how it's done. But the main question and main answer that probably people will still always argue with me on, I'm excited for Andrew Garfield coming back. He was my favorite Spider-Man. I thought he did a great job. I enjoyed those movies. Obviously, there was parts that I did not fucking enjoy. Like any comic book movie, you know what I mean? But I really enjoyed his performance. I thought he was really good. And the big thing that I always put to that is, I love, you know, we both love Batman and the character and the stories that have come with movies since the beginning and the television shows and everything. Most of the time I can say certain actors were amazing Batman, not so great Bruce Wayne. George Clooney is Bruce Wayne.
Yeah.
He was just a shit Batman, you know? I think Andrew Garfield, to me, was great Peter Parker and great Spider-Man. Tobey Maguire, not so much. and everybody is losing their shit on that. And I think the biggest thing is that, yes, like you said, we grew up on that. That is our franchise that we, you know, started with, lived through, same as the original X-Men franchise. Of those are who we knew from the start. That was it. That was the version of like our parents and grandparents that grew up during the Adam West era.
Yeah.
We grew up during this era. So it is kind of cool, no matter what, no matter how much of a fan you are of certain characters and certain actors, it's definitely going to be interesting to see it play out. I hope it's good. That's the one thing, not that I don't hope these other shows and stuff are, you know, don't succeed and whatnot. I hope they do. But I really, really hope this Spider-Man movie is what it seems like they want to do and sounds like. Again, that could be fucking awful, but I hope it's good. I hope they put a lot of time into it. I hope they don't just try to say, oh, now this character's here, now that character. I just hope it makes sense, it goes together, and the whole, you know, effort in the end is to make it profitable enough to where they could build something off of it. And if that means, hell, if that means Tobey Maguire's Spider-Man comes back after this, fine. If they kill him off in this, fine. You know, you gotta do one thing to get the other one going. It's just interesting. And same thing, although I always want as much comic book accuracy as I can get, I also understand and I'm okay with them doing their own version as long as it makes sense and is a decent flick, you know? So at the end, I hope it succeeds. I want it to, and that'll be an interesting movie just to see play out. But
yeah, I'm for it. I think it's a lot, especially when you're bringing all the love interest into it as well. It's like, it's a lot of story arcs. Like you said, I did hear that rumor that like, it's just going to be like action sequences that you see kind of like Into the Spider-Verse when they showed the other Spider-Man. You just saw moments of him fighting other villains. And I think people are going to see like William Dafoe and they're going to think he's like the main fucking villain, but I doubt that actually is the payoff there. I did think like it could be interesting, but it's a lot, man. That's a movie that should have like the Snyder cut length. Just if you want to get everything done and tell it in the right amount of time. And then they're saying Daredevil's going to be in it. I'm just like, dude, like it just sounds like freaking Doctor Strange is in it as well. It's like, it's a lot to bring in into a movie that you left off with a cliffhanger when you brought back the original J. Jonah Jameson. And they're like, we know who Spider-Man's is and he's going to court. And it's like, okay, well then most of us were like, okay, cool. Maybe Daredevil's in it. For them to be like, Andrew's back, Toby's back, the original Mary Jane is back, Emma Stone is back. Like, it's like, damn, bro. Like that's just a lot for like people to put in that information. Like you said, like we grew up pretty much with Toby as Spider-Man and like Hugh Jackman as Wolverine. Those to us were with like Kevin Smith's Keaton to Batman. You know what I mean? Like that's the one where they freaked out about in 89. We freaked out about that in 99 and 2000. That was what he was to us. So to bring that all back together, it's like, it's either going to be a hit or miss. It's either going to work really well. I would want Sam Raimi to be like the co-director in it. I doubt they do it, but I think Sam Raimi, who's already directing the next Doctor Strange movie, which is crazy. If they're able to bring him into some capacity, I think they could pull it off. It's Marvel. I mean, who am I to doubt them? They did everything with Infinity War and everything they have accomplished with everything they've done. But I think this is a little bit too much. And that was kind of my problem with Endgame at the ending. I'm like, I know you're bringing them all back, but that's a lot, dude. And like, I know there's a payoff. Is this big third act, but it's like, it's a lot. Like you have this scene, that scene. I can't really pay attention to everything that's going on because you're just doing too much. It ends up being a lot for the audience sometimes. Like, for somebody that saw the original trilogy of Star Wars and the new trilogy, I'm like, you're doing too less. But Marvel is doing a lot. And it's like, there's no even ground, though. So I'm kind of like, just do it at this point. I'm like, just accomplish it. If it doesn't work, it doesn't work. People are going to bitch either way, no matter what. It's never going to be the most pristine way they've done it, especially, and that's the problem when you go back to nostalgia. It has to be either be the way it was when we were kids, or it's never going to work. So I don't know. It's interesting, man. It's going to be very interesting to see how they pull it off. I'm very suspect about like the end game of it all, though. Like, it just seems like you're opening too many doors. I get it. And my problem is, you guys heard that Keaton was coming back as Batman, and then you guys were like, fucking sound Doctor Strange, we're opening our fucking worlds too. And it's like, damn, dude, like, that's a lot to take in from like two franchises. Like, let's just slow down a little bit. Like, I'm not even over the fact that we're gonna see Michael Keaton in the 89 bat suit. Now you're gonna want me to see Andrew Garfield in the Spider-Man suit and fucking Toby. It's like, it's a lot of shit to take in, but we'll see if they pull it off. It's either gonna be hit or miss.
Yeah. And I mean, that's the other thing too, again, to like end on that. They've asked or like talked about, like, well, are they going to all have their original suits? Are they going to have different ones? And then they've talked about the villains, though, saying, oh, they might most likely will have different suits. And I'm like, I'd much rather see every single villain have a different costume as opposed to Spider-Man. You can have all three of them in their original costumes. I won't care. But when you include the villains, I hope Green Goblin looks fucking better. I hope if they include, you know, say Rhino, because someone's going to call Paul Giamatti for some reason. I hope he looks better. Every character of that, I hope looks better because I can't. I mean, I'm sure I could. I was trying to think of like certain. I really didn't like Green Goblin's costume. I know they were trying to go for it, but I want to see the pink and green. I want to see the goofy goblin costume. Like,
well, you make seen, it look like the it's online. It's like the test.
The original. The goblin. Yeah.
I'm cool. Oh, with that.
That one looked great. I don't know why the fuck they didn't go with it, because it's not like we saw Willem Dafoe's face under the mask. So why not put him in a rubber fucking goblin costume, you know?
Mm-hmm.
I think it could work, but who knows, man?
Yeah. I mean, let's try to make it past the week. See what the fuck is the way things are going.
Right.
I know both of, like, me and you, we only got two questions for this week. I know you got one. I'll let you start it off since we're like,
man, lazy, lazy bastards couldn't ask us more questions, but
it's like Matt's and Mark's all over again.
I know, man. Every week we just ask them to ask us any fucking stupid wrestling related thing, and
so we start asking ourselves.
Yeah, so we start asking each other questions, and then people are like, they're just talking the whole time. We're like, what the fuck did you want? My question, though, was from a wrestling fan, actually. Not wrestling related, though, so go figure. They asked me if I checked out, and if I did check it out, what did I think of the New Mutants movie? So we're flipping to the Marvel side, I guess, even though it's not. What? So what franchise did that one cut off from? That was like the newer X-Men.
It's the Bryan Singer X-Men still. It's like still in that universe of like the last Dark Phoenix movie, which is awful as fuck. Yeah. So it's still in that genre. It was pretty much the final chapter of the Fox X-Men.
Yeah, and it took forever to come out. And then they were like, we're going to do different cuts of it. And then they were the ones to be like, never mind, we're just here. And everybody was just kind of like, ah, shit, all right. Did you see it or no?
No, I did not. I did not want to see it. I've heard so much about it, and I already read the script for it, and I was like,
yeah.
It took 3 years, 2 years actually, for it to come out. I'm like, I don't care anymore. It's the final chapter. It's not going to build to anything.
No.
It's a standalone. I'm like, horror in a mutant's world doesn't make sense to me, really. I know the comic is good, but it's just on movie form. I never cared about
it. Well, and that's the biggest, right off the bat, I'll tell you right now. Smart on their side, but also I think it would have been funnier. There was no after credits. There was no anything, like, at all. And I thought that was interesting because I'm like, beforehand, they thought, oh, this is going to continue. This is going to be great.
Yep.
Why didn't you cut something? You know what I mean? Just to still be like, ha, 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 you're not getting anything. like a very Green Lantern ending of being like, this is gonna go somewhere, and you're like,
you're Sinestro, he's evil, never see him again,
this shit ain't doing nothing. So yeah, and then the horror side of it from the beginning, that was the biggest thing that at least I heard people talk about when it was first, you know, being made and everything like that, was, oh my god, Marvel's first like horror movie. And I'm like, one, no it's not, and at least yes, it would have been their first one. Was it going to be successful? No. Because no horror movie in the last 10 years, in my opinion, has been successful. And everybody can argue with that, but unless it is rated R right off the bat, no horror movie that I have actually sat down and watched is ever living up to the par that it's set. Because one, I love gore, I love blood, I love violence. If they don't have that in a horror movie, to me, it's not a horror movie. It is a suspense, thriller, whatever, that passes as PG-13. So when you drop the H on it and you're saying that it is full horror, full this, it's not, you lied to me. So that being said for this one, the other side that I loved at first, and I would have been so much more happy with, they were describing it as very Nightmare 3?
On Elm Street, yeah.
3 or 4. Right? Dream Warriors. Is that 3 or 4?
First one is with the girl. Second one's with the guy, right? So third one.
Great fucking song for the soundtrack. Fucking docking for days. Yeah. But I thought, so that was the whole kind of idea and premise, because you got all these kids in this like hospital and they're learning their powers and whatnot, but it was kind of being described as that. It was not. You have them battling these kind of weird, you know, I can describe it as, going back for fans of Buffy the Vampire Slayer, it was a cross between like the Gentlemen, which scared the shit out of me as a kid and still probably would as an adult, meets almost like very just weird mummy like looking characters. It was just very strange. And the whole time I'm still thinking, okay, this is going to be some weird creation or this or that. It really wasn't. It was all every kid's dealing with their powers. And then you got Colossus's sister, that is magic or whatever. Hers is the only one that was really like, oh, that's kind of like horror like, because it's all the ones in her mind that she's creating.
Oh shit, okay.
So you're like, oh, okay. But it's never like, oh, she's the villain, not knowing. I thought it was going to go that route too, being like, oh, the reveal is that it's been her the whole time. Not really. It's still just kind of like, no. And then you got the other little girl from Game of Thrones running around as like the animal one. And it was so much shit that you're like, what is going on? And then I can't even remember the other three characters. The one, I don't want to say it's Sunspot, because I don't think it was, and it's not Sunfire. So I'm like, well, which fucking one is it then? Because I'm getting confused. Yeah, it was just a lot to try to
introduce all at once.
Yeah. And then, yeah, like you already said, while watching it, I knew it was going nowhere. Mm-hmm. I knew it was not going to add to anything. And I, you know, some people were like, oh, but it takes place more so in like the Logan time frame. Not really. Like, it's because they looked at that as, oh, this is going to be the new characters that can build off of how Logan ended with those characters. Clearly, we all saw that nothing's going to come of X-23. So those characters will never meet, nor were they probably going to with this film.
Yeah.
So you didn't really have to do that. But the thing that always that did stand out to me is, yet again, when the movie was being filmed and everything, they maybe knew a little bit more than others. But to me, they didn't know that it wasn't going to go anywhere. There is like little to no mention or tie-in with like anything else, any other character or any other movie, really. And I remember like thinking that, being like, maybe I just didn't see it. There's like nothing. It really is like their own movie that
just stands alone.
Whole time I'm like, Still nothing. I thought yet again there was going to be like a nod to like Essex or Mr. Sinister and piss me off since I still have yet to see a live action version of him. But nothing, like no mention at all, nothing. And if they mentioned Xavier or anything, I forgot about it already because I don't remember it. It was just very weird that that was how they really ended it. You know what I mean?
Yeah, like that's from where it started with X-Men, X2, X3. Yeah. They reboot it. They did a pretty good job rebooting it, and then they went to shit again for that to be like the final chapter. It's like, damn, bro.
The dumb thing that they could have even had, and it would have pissed me off at the moment, but still been like, oh, whatever. They could have still brought up the Stryker character since they brought him back so many times. They could have still tried saying nothing. And I was, you know, okay, you know. But, yeah, so that was – and the ending is just them, I guess, kind of succeeding and being like, we know how to control our powers, kind of, but we'll keep getting better. And then they just walk off into like the distance, and you're like, "Fuck! All right, like, just, and
Power
that's
Rangers
it.
Prequel." The
yeah, like they're just like now would, we know what to do.
They would have been so much better if it wasn't attached to X-Men. If it was just a standalone that they're like, "These are new characters that we're introducing," has some horror elements to it, but it has nothing to do with any like franchise you've ever seen. That's the problem when you add like that stipulation because you're trying to sell tickets to be like, this is connected to X-Men and you might see some of your favorite characters or you might not, and then you don't. Yeah. It's like, what's connected? There's nothing connected. There are mutants, fine, but it's like, it's not really. Just make it a series. They would have been better off making it a series for like Disney at some point and just like selling it,
it
from there.
It could have been their version of Titans. You know what I mean? Of Which these characters. Oh man, it's well, yeah, I was gonna say it's good. First season's good, second season's better. So that's what made me interested in the next season coming out. Well, you know,
what'd you think of Redhead?
I'm fucking really interested. Yeah, I'm definitely interested because, you know, I'm a huge, probably one of the biggest Red Hood fans. So yeah, I'm interested in that. I'm curious on how they'll do it too, because there's a lot of different ways they can introduce that. Obviously, yeah. I don't think we're going with the original. To where, again, if it's its own different version and whatever, and it works, it works, you know.
Well, but they've shown Joker in that series, right? Like, not like full.
Yeah.
Don't they have like that like nightmare kind of type of thing where like Batman's gone crazy and kills just Joker?
Kills everyone, man. That is a good scene, actually. Just if you can't watch the whole show just yet, watch certain like scenes and stuff. That is a good scene. It's like a whole montage of Robin going through Arkham. And see all the different characters dead. They never show someone like face or anything, but they do it a really good way. So yeah, with Joker, since that's the one that everybody knows, I don't want to spoil other ones because it's a very cool scene. Joker, you see him face down, but you see the purple jacket, the the classic gloves, the green hair, and then the next part, other scene that you see him is in like a hospital bed. Which I'm just like, I laugh at envisioning any character of like Batman or something like that in an actual hospital. Cause you're like, wouldn't you just take him to jail then finally, you know?
Yeah. But, like, why are you going to give him like attention to like,
yeah.
You know, it was funny. That's literally what they did in Birds of Prey with the Joker. They literally just showed the back.
Oh
the,
yeah. The purple, the
green hair. It was literally not Jared Leto, which I'm like,
yeah.
So why does Harley still look like whatever? That's DC.
I know. Anyway, exactly.
Yeah. Second question I got, it comes from the homie Orangey Edwin, you know who he is. Just asking me, cause I know he's getting into it. If I collect cards, sports, Pokemon, stuff like that. You used to collect Pokemon, literally had a giant binder like everybody else did, I believe. And, it disappeared, so it angers me now when I see how much they sell for, because I feel like I had some legitimately good ones. As for sports, that's tough, man. I remember my uncle had like a giant stack of like vintage baseball cards. We go take them, they're like, it's only worth $5. So I'm like, this is a shitty business. I know he's collecting them now. Good luck, bro. I don't know why you're getting into that as a hobby, because you got to be real lucky. It's like hitting the lottery when it comes to sports cards. But as for like Pokemon and shit, yeah, that shit used to be like, I used to be into that shit, dude. Like, that and Digimon was like my go-to for a little bit, like where I would just collect the fuck out of them, man. And now I see like Charizard go for like 2,000, and there's moments where I'm like, I think I had that one, and like now it's gone.
You know, the funny thing about Pokemon cards are, though, out of all the ones that we both collected Did you ever actually sit down and play a game of Pokemon?
No, never, never.
I don't think I want to say I tried. And then I think, just any time was like, what the fuck is this? Look at this cool one. It shines. And I'm like, I think that's my biggest.
Never learned how
now.
To play them, dude. Never. Like, no. You just collected them. That's what they were for. But they had like the whole game because I remember, I don't know if you ever bought them, like the metal case where it would have like the dice and shit.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. But yeah, same thing. I'm like, no, you know, that's the funnier part about it. That I'm like, I don't think I ever actually successfully played a fucking game.
Fuck no.
you know.
That was a waste of time. That would have been.
Oh, yeah. That would have been major. Pretty much.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, this has been another episode. I don't know what number this is. I might just number this number one since it's been such a long time between.
This is just, it's going to go the Goldberg streak. We're just going to, every episode is going to go like 100 points in. And there's like, wait, I missed 99 through 200. You're like, yeah, dude, catch up. But there's no catching up. It's just there.
Well, we'll definitely be around. I know I'll upload some videos here and there. I know you guys want reaction videos. I don't want to do that anymore just due to copyright and stuff like that. Definitely, I know we'll get back to talking. Definitely when Snyder Cut comes out, I'm sure we'll even do one maybe for WandaVision because I know that's the only one like you that I actually want to see how they pull that off, especially with Doctor Strange and how they open that whole world. It's literally going to be like the Flash and Flashpoint from everything that they've been saying. So that's going to be very interesting. Everything other than that, ladies and gentlemen, we will see you guys very soon. Thank you so much for watching. But as always, leave your comments down below. If you thought differently of Wonder Woman, hey man, convince me. Maybe you can give me a different point of view than I thought. I mean, I just, from my first POV, that's what I thought. If you saw it differently, let me know. Comment sections down below. There's no links in the description anymore. So just comment down below, slap that thumb. We'll see you guys later on. You guys enjoy the rest of your night. Rossi.
Have a good one, guys.
Hey, guys.